I am a sister of charity of Nazareth, but I work for the Sisters of Charity Federation, a group of 13 congregations based in US and Canada. So I am an NGO representative at the United Nations. And the Vincentian family has a good representation at the United Nations. How many of you know your own NGO representatives there? Tell me, yes? Daughters of Charity, who do you have? Catherine Prendergast. AIC? Natalie Boone. Mm-hmm. And CM?
Guillermo Cambusano.
So we have a good presence at the United Nations. Why are we there? Jim talked about being in the present. We are being present to the problems that people on the margins, on the periphery, or those who live in poverty face. We are trying to advocate in the name of the people who live on the margins and who have no voice. By our baptism, we are called to be prophets. So speak true to the power, to be pastoral, and to be radically working for social change. The United Nations is all about peace and security, human rights and fundamental freedoms, and development, which is integrative of social, economic, and environmental development for all, not for a few. What kind of a world are we living in right now? I want you to be part of this session. What kind of a world are we living in now? Is it a good world? I don't buy that. I don't buy it. It's a very divided, polarized world we are living in. Us versus them, the rich versus the poor, the haves versus the have-nots, and the gap between the countries, within countries, is widening. So it's not a good time to live, but it is an interesting time to live, because we have the opportunity to take action. And we have a commitment to take action. The Vatican II has told us that we should be looking at the signs of the times. What does the world present us in the here and now? What does the church teach us right now? So these are the things that we need to pay attention to, be at the UN and respond according to our charism, Catholic social teaching, and the charter of the UN itself. So transforming our world, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development is a document that came out in 2015. September 25th of that year, Pope Francis visited the UN. He spoke to all the 193 member states. Right after he left, the President of the General Assembly took the gavel and banged it and said, "This assembly adopts this agenda." This agenda is like a manifesto for common good, for justice. How many of you have heard about Millennium Development Goals? Many of you heard, you worked for it. But Millennium Development Goals were made by the experts and given to developing and poor countries and told, hey, you work on it, we will help you with some money, you can come up like us. But it didn't produce the result that was required. It did lift people out of poverty, it improved the health and, you know, of mothers and children. Some of the communicable diseases were controlled, but it's around a 50% result. There wasn't that much commitment from the governments as well as not sufficient finances to really lift people out of poverty. So in 2012, during the Rio de Janeiro conference, that was the 20th anniversary of the first 1992 Earth Conference, some of the countries said the Millennium Development Goals will be ending in 2015. What is the way forward? We need to work on a sustainable development goals that includes the environment also. So far, development meant economic development. But that's not all. So they said it has to have a third pillar, environment. So that's where the impetus came from for this document. And this time, all 193 governments worked with civil society, that is, all the people of the world, academicians, NGOs, experts, all the other UN organizations, they had an open working forum. So it is a product of everyone's collaboration. It's not the product of some experts. So it's a universal call for action. It's not just for poor countries, it's for everyone. There is poverty, inequality, lack of homelessness, or hunger, lack of education, lack of employment is seen in rich and poor countries alike. So I will go quickly, you will be getting a copy because time is limited. So this 2030 agenda for sustainable development, we call in short SDGs, is for prosperity of all and for the present generation and for the coming generation. We don't eat up all. Sustainable development meets the needs of the people of today as well as the needs of the next generation. And it's all about people. It's all about the care of the planet. So people and planet are at the heart of the agenda. It's about leaving no one behind. This is equal to the common good. Leave no one behind. We should, when we involve in the society, lift people out, we should go to the last person. Not to the just from the top of the margin. That's what often happens. It's all about development beyond economic. These numbers don't speak, you know, who is really out of poverty. It's a universal agenda. All countries need to implement, as well as it is an integrated system. There are 17 goals, 169 targets with 232 indicators to measure those targets. So they tell us, don't pick and choose one of them. Our focus must be one, but we can interconnect, integrate all the other aspects. So we need to see where the system connects. So if we neglect one, we are neglecting all. So this is the three pillars of sustainable development: the social, the economic, and the environmental. And they all intersect and interact. So acting in one circle impacts all the other circles. So this agenda is supposed to provide dignity to people. So dignity means ending poverty and fight inequality. Poverty is a denial of the human right of an individual. So as long as they keep remaining in poverty, they have no dignity. We need to ensure that people have healthy lives, knowledge, inclusion of women and children in development, justice, promote safe and peaceful societies. Unless we have institutions that work for everyone without corruption, we will not be having safe societies. And prosperity grows strong not just for 1% of the world, but for everyone. Transform the economy and protect the ecosystems. And we need the partnership of everyone. We can't do it alone. No country can do it alone. No NGO or no group can do it alone. It calls for not only global partnership, at the grassroots level also it calls for partnership. Now I'm beginning. The first goal is end poverty in all its forms everywhere. There are 7 targets. I won't go into that. Extreme poverty is a human rights violation. Persons living in poverty are deprived of their economic rights, social access to health and education, political freedom to participate, and cultural right for an identity as their group. How do we measure poverty? Tell me. Don't look at the board there. How do we measure poverty? Basic needs. But often what is the common understanding? They don't have money. They have no job. But are they poor? They have resources. But they don't have the opportunity. So measuring poverty has changed. See, now we measure multi-dimensional poverty. See, there are 10 indicators. Health, it has 3 dimensions of poverty, education and living standard. All those things together measure whether a person is poor. It's not just the amount of money that person earns. Will we end poverty by 2030? We adopted this in 2016, January. It is already 3 years gone by. The rate at which the governments are making known to their own people this agenda, as well as investing money and employing people, we don't think poverty will be eradicated. Today, more than 3 billion people live on less than $2.5. That's half the world almost. We are 7 billion. And 1.3 billion live in extreme poverty, less than $1.25. So you can see 783 million live in poverty. So you had seen this quote when Jim talked about, it is something we human beings have made. So what we made, we can undo, we can do away with poverty. It's not because we don't lack the resources, because our priorities are wrong. How can we ensure that people will move out of poverty? We are saying, give a human rights-based social protection clause. If each government says, when we say human rights-based, it's from life cycle. From birth till the grave, there is some sort of protection in terms of either financial money or in kind government gives, then people will not fall through the cracks. Say a sickness or lack of employment will not wipe them out and make them pauper. So, goal 2 is end hunger. It has got 8 targets. All things to do with agriculture is in this goal. Food is also a human right. Poverty is the number one cause of hunger. 842 million people have nothing to, not enough to eat. That is 1 in 7 persons. So these are some of the statistics. Hunger kills more people than HIV/AIDS or malaria or tuberculosis. Goal 3 is well-being, promote well-being of the people. That means government should provide basic universal health care protection, the social medicine. Ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and lifelong learning opportunities for all. You see, 63 million primary school age children are out of school. 61 million lower secondary school children are out of school. 139 million higher secondary children are out of school. So we have a long way to go in providing education. This is all about children. What about the adults who are illiterate? So there is a new shift in education. It's education for global citizenship. From the traditional priorities of access to quality education, from a sense of community to instill in people, locally, nationally, globally. We belong to the global community. We are not just, I'm not just from Indonesia, but I am part of the global community. Provide universal values of understanding, respect, tolerance, friendship, human rights and fundamental freedoms, peace, non-violence. So it is a new understanding of the universe, unity in diversity. It is also creating a more peaceful, tolerant, inclusive world. So what is the role of us as educators, whether formally or informally we are involved in? Cultivate a questioning mind. Create a sense of solidarity with the rest of the human world. Transform from personal to social to regional to global. Act effectively and responsibly. This is one of the most goals among all the 17 goals. Gender equality and empowerment of women and girls. There are 9 targets. If we don't focus on this, we are not going to achieve any kind of development. Because women and girls play a central role in development, in family and education, you name it, healthcare. So the issues and challenges before us about women empowerment and gender equality are patriarchy. The man knows better. Sexual division of labor. From birth we say, hey, boys don't do that. That's only girls do. Macroeconomics and trade. Women are not given access to that. Environmental, natural resources, climate change. They impact women differently. Decent work. Women are tied up with unpaid care work in their homes. Unpaid. The government doesn't take account of the amount of money a woman brings in terms of the number of hours she spends at home. So you can see, it's never calculated into the GDP. It's just overlooked. Oh, she's just a housewife. So how are women and girls impacted? Climate change, environmental issues, they affect women differently than men. Often the men go out to look for jobs for survival. But who is left to care for the family? The major responsibility is borne by the woman. Migrant women and refugees, how much difficulties the women face. Imagine a woman with a child walking miles, or a pregnant woman without any access to basic health services and sanitation, walking for days and months. Conflicts, terrorism, violent extremism, they affect women and children, girls differently. Today, rape is an acknowledged form of retaliation women face. So, child marriages. Is there child marriage here in Indonesia? You have practice of FGM, female genital mutilation, among the Muslim. So find out, it's a practice among Muslims. We are working to stop that. Even in the US, there is child marriage. Many of the state governments still have laws that allow child marriage with the permission of parents. So no country is free from it. There are 21 million people who are under forced labor, and 22% of that are trafficked women, girls, men and boys into sexual labor. So how can we achieve gender equality? End discrimination right from the home. Don't treat a boy child and a girl child differently. Eliminate violence. 1 in 3 women face intimate partner or home violence all over the world. So it's so much prevalent. Eliminate child forced marriages, female genital mutilation. Recognize the value of unpaid care work a woman does in her home. Access to lifelong learning. Equal rights to economic resources. Can a woman open a bank account? Here it happens freely in the rural areas without her husband's permission. Does she have access to financial resources? Can she take a bank loan without a collateral? No. See, the governmental policies on inheritance, right to own land, those things need to change. So until and unless women have economic independence, economic rights, she is not going to be empowered. So the next goal is water and sanitation. In 2010, the UN declared water and sanitation are human rights. So we all have a right to have access to clean drinking water and sanitation. See what happens. 663 million people, 1 in 10 lakh access to water. 1 in 3 people lack access to toilets, that is 2.4 billion. There are more cell phones than toilets in the world. 1 in 3 schools lack access to toilets and, you know, water. So girl children stop going to schools. We advocated for keeping the term human right to water and sanitation in this document during the negotiations. It took 6 months just to get 2 words, human right to water and sanitation, because the rich countries wanted to keep those 2 words out so that they can make their corporations go into developing countries and privatize water and sanitation. In South Africa and Kenya, there are water ATMs. So who can get water if you have water ATMs? The rich. So the poor end up drinking dirty water anyhow. So we have to make sure that our own governments, these water and sanitation is a right. Government is the duty bearer. They should provide that public service, not through corporations. So we worked 6 months through 621 organizations from 90 countries just to get the word human right in the declaration of the statement. So the changes we make are small, but they can impact. So goal 7 is renewable energy. Solar, wind, other forms of energy, so that our dependence on fossil fuel can be eliminated, because fossil fuel is increasing the heat, carbon emission into the planet, atmosphere, global warming, sea level rising, so a lot of consequences. But many people say it's all fake news. Promote sustained inclusive growth and employment. It is our job of the government to do that. Provide adequate employment, decent jobs. Only when you have a decent job, Jim showed no job, no food, no health, no education. So the cycle, generational poverty will continue. One generation to the next. So build resilient infrastructure. The government need to build roads, transportation, railroads, schools, hospitals. All those infrastructure is supposed to be provided by the government. But the present movement is, government says, our pockets are empty, so we are calling on corporations, multinationals, come, we are just putting out a red carpet for you to come, we will give you tax-free land, you don't need to pay any income tax for so many years, come and do, set up these things. But who is the loser? The citizens. Because when there is profit, it goes to the pocket of the corporations. When there is deficit, the taxpayers' money is paid up. So we need to be careful when government is saying, inviting everybody else to do the infrastructure projects. Reduce inequalities. How many of you read the Oxfam report they produced on the world scenario on who owns how much money? It's nice for you to look up, it's available on the internet. Inequalities in income and wealth have been widening globally. The richest 1% of the world own 40% of the wealth. So 80 people have earned the most 50% of the wealth this past year. So are we going to bridge? So the poorest 10% earn only between 2 and 7% of the total global income. Make cities and human settlements inclusive, safe, resilient and sustainable. Who is living in the cities? Tell me, who is living in the cities? Those who are working. But who has the best house? The rich. Where are the poor living in the cities? On the periphery, on the periphery. And they need to spend more money to get a home, more money to find a transportation for their work. So is our city safe and inclusive?
No.
So what is happening is, even if the middle class has land or buildings in the city, they are selling it to developers who put up condominiums for the rich, and the poor move further out. So it is not an inclusive city. Ensure sustainable consumption and production. What is one of the biggest sickness in our world today? Any guess? Obesity.
Mataba.
Obesity, because we are consuming more than we need. So we are producing We need to reduce our carbon footprint. Agriculture is the biggest user of water. 70% of all fresh water is used for agriculture. And 50% of all that we produce is wasted either in the farm or in transportation or in the supermarket. The rest in the restaurants. So we don't have sufficient food. We have only very little water left for human consumption. So we need to see what kind of production and consumption we need. We need to do sustainably. Goal 13 is on climate change. I'm sure you have learned a whole lot in your readings. We see every day the impact of climate change happening right now. More rains, floods, extreme heats, you know, landslides. So it is very important. So the Paris Climate Agreement happened during the COP21. COP is Conference of Parties. It took place in 2015, the same year as this Transforming Our Agenda SDGs came out. That is the second document. So 197 countries are parties to this agreement. The US has pulled out. These are not imposed upon. Each country prepared their own nationally determined contributions to lower the carbon emissions. But we are not on target. Goal 14 is all about oceans. Any guess how many billion people depend on the ocean for their livelihood? Guess. Any guess? Take a guess. You are not going to lose. 6 billion. 3 billion people either directly or indirectly are affected by the way we treat our oceans. How many million tons of plastic ends up in our oceans? 37 million tons of earth. So our oceans are becoming our garbage dump. And what are we doing to the fish and all that life underneath the ocean floor? We are destroying. And all the ships that carry all the goods, there is a movie called Sonic Sea. S-O-N-I-C. Sonic Sea. You can see it. It's online, freely available. See it. Why are whales dying? Because their inner ear is affected by all the noise. Then they bleed. That's how they beach. And even if you put them back in the sea, they don't live. So we need to be careful about how we treat our sea. This is protect our ecosystems, what we have on our Earth planet. We have only one planet Earth. We don't have a plan B. And the way we live, we need 3.5 planets to sustain us. So we need to preserve the diversity, the ecosystems, promote peaceful, inclusive societies, development, for, provide access to justice, build effective, accountable, inclusive institutions. This is referring to how our governments govern, rule. How our government machinery works. Does everyone have access to it for justice, for all their needs? Is it inclusive? So corruption free. So this is what we are, we all have a hand in making this happen. Every minute, nearly 20 people are displaced as a result of conflict, persecution. At the end of 2016, the total number of forcibly displaced people were 65.6 million. So who is responsible for the conflict? Governments. When there is uprising, people know there is something is happening, but nobody is doing anything about it until it gets out of hand. It becomes a war zone. So corruption, bribery, theft and tax evasion cost developing countries $1.26 trillion a year. Our governments or our rich politicians take the money out of the country. Our corporations, multinationals, they do not pay taxes to the smaller countries where they work. The continent of Africa, they get 130 totally the global aid from rich countries is 130 billion. Africa gets around 50 billion and they lose 100 billion as tax evasion or illicit financial flows. Most of Africa's goods are in terms of mineral resources. It is not refined, its quality is not added in the chain of quality chain, hence they can't get money. But the corporations, when they say, you know, this one ton of mineral ore is only $5 worth here, so they pay tax for $5. They get it out of the country, its value becomes $100. So that is illicit financial flows. It is happening from Indonesia also. So without peace, stability, human rights and effective governance based on the rule of law, we cannot hope for sustainable development. Reduce all forms of violence in society. Find lasting solutions. We need to have rule of law. We need the participation of all developing countries in global governance. Finance, trade, taxation. Small countries have no place at the table. It is decided by Organization for Economic Development and Cooperation called OECD. 30 countries control all global trade, all global taxation, all the financial institutions. So that's why when Jim said, if you are not at the table, you are on the menu. They may invite you, discuss, but you are not part of it. So goal 17 is for partnership, collaboration. I will not speak, you heard. Systemic change or any kind of change, we can't do it alone. This is partnership at the global, local, regional, all levels. So SDG seeks to realize the human rights of all. It is an agenda grounded in human rights. Implement them through partnership and collaboration. That's our So it's all about being more, not having more. So we are standing at a critical moment in the history of humankind. We need to choose what kind of future do we want. We need to have a paradigm shift. The turning point in human history, it can be directing us in the right way. So how do we do that? You need to identify a local cycle of poverty. Work with all stakeholders, all those who have a hand in removing it. So collaboration. Be smart and flexible. Share your area of expertise. And our challenge is to connect ecological devastation, I can't read it, displacement, impoverishment, exclusion and discrimination, enslavement, inequality. So look at the SDGs through the lens of Laudato Si. Because Laudato Si came out while the negotiations were going on June 16th, 18th, 2015. So employ the principles of Catholic social teaching. Jim will be giving it to you in detail tomorrow. So let all your actions be rights-based, grounded in human rights, and also they are grounded in the UN Charter. So you can blaze a new trail to change, transform our world. Be a part of this new revolution, transforming our world. You can look on the internet for 2030 agenda, sustainable development goals. You will get the document. It is long. All the goals with their detailed targets are there. So, thank you.